Please welcome Joan Baez. Welcome, welcome to Scandinavia.
Oh, this is a wonderful show. I mean, I'm in culture shock. In the States, a long segment is 4.5 minutes maximum.
Oh, well, yeah. We have a lot of time.
I know, it's so wonderful.
when I saw these pictures, I mean, this brings back memories for many, but, mm-hmm. but how is it for you to see the pictures from back in the days? Who were you then?
It's hard to think of that young person as me now. I appreciate watching her and what she did. And it was just, I just see a gifted young woman who had already decided to do what her life, what she did. You know, take the voice and use it for social change and doing as much good as I could.
Have you changed? I mean, a lot of your views are still the same, but have you changed as a person?
I think if you reach my age, which is 77, and don't think you've changed at all, then you're really delusional. Mm. So I'm sure I have, but I would say the foundation of my life, which really was nonviolence, nonviolent action, attempt to live a nonviolent life, that stayed the same. Mm. I'm not saying I have, but I'm saying that's... No, that's what one tries to do. That stayed the same through thick and thin, and here I am.
people called you very... You had this very serious image.
Oh, God, I know. It went forever.
But what was it like? I mean, becoming famous, I mean, quite overnight, in a way, as a very young person, Did you deal well with that? Did you deal well with fame during the years? I mean,
what I did is I went overboard. I didn't want to be commercial. I didn't want to ride around in limousines. I didn't want to have anything to do with Hollywood. So I went the other direction, which was probably just as big a bore, because to keep me happy, the stage had to be pitch black, no flags, no flowers, you know. And somebody commented, well, she's just as difficult as having a rock band. Because at least they had some freedom to try and make the place look nice. But I'm glad that I chose the direction I did, because I probably would get lost in the way a lot of young people do, or people do, in that sparkling world of nonsense.
Do you think that in general that you could be a difficult person to work with?
Yeah. I would probably have to ask the people who work with me, but right now I'm not so bad. Yeah.
Well, we saw a clip here of Bob Dylan, and you were very important in his career. Mm-hmm. You gave him a lot bigger audience, and you performed a lot together. Mm. Could he be difficult to work with?
That's an even bigger laugh than you asked about me. I think so.
I'm trying to say that with an understatement.
I know you are. you know, the inevitable talk about Bob, mm-hmm. so I just want to say that I appreciate him. Mm-hmm. I care about him. Recently, he said some really nice things about me. No, and that time period with him and the other very gifted people, 60s and 70s, is something that will never happen again. It was some kind of explosion of talent and gifts, and then that many more people wanting to be engaged in some kind of action, either civil rights or against the war in Vietnam. And so people now are longing for that feeling. And I have to say that the closest thing to that feeling that's happened since then is happening right now with the students in Florida. You get the feeling that a real movement is going to build out of this, which is fascinating. You have these 15-year-old kids standing at the microphone saying, we're not going to accept this anymore. We're not going to accept the NRA. And then you see National Rifle Association. And then you see Delta Airlines and Hertz Rent-A-Car saying they're going to pull, distance themselves from the National Rifle Association. Well, that's never happened. If it took this little bunch of kids, and they seem dead serious about it. So.
And this is, I mean, you're going to do a very relevant song for us a little later. About this topic, in a way.
Yeah.
But I wonder, because you've been an activist for so long. You even marched with Martin Luther King. And you've been very influential to people from different worlds, like Bob Dylan, I mentioned, Martin Luther King, and you were even dating or an item with Steve Jobs, the founder of Apple. And these are so different worlds, but they are so influential, these people. And they were influenced by you as well. Do these people have anything in common that you can recognize?
They're all complicated.
They're all complicated. Yeah. I had an interview with, I think she was an Australian journalist over the phone, long distance, had a lot of questions, a lot of answers. And then she said, I have one last question. And I said, sure. And she said, do you realize you're the only woman in the world who's seen both Bob Dylan and Steve Jobs naked? And I said, at the same time? She said, no.
Are you comfortable with the term protest singer?
If people, I mean, there are worse things, but that's not how I've considered what I've done. I mean, they're very, I think a protest song is more about the context of where you're singing it and then it is about the words of the song. I mean, for instance, when my ex-husband was in prison for draft resistance, what he loved best was Merle Haggard and country western songs. So I would say, I'm dedicating this to my husband who is blah, 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 and explain about the war and so on. And then I'd sing country and western song. So you couldn't, it was as far from a protest song as you could get, but used in that context, that's how it works.
You've done more than singing, performing and talking. You traveled a lot and you traveled into war zones. We were telling Farah's story here from Lebanon.
Yeah.
I know that you were in, back in 72, you were in Hanoi. Mm-hmm. When the bombs fell really hard. Mm-hmm. Can you take us back there for a moment?
Well, when I went, it was as a peace group, to meet with a peace group in Hanoi. They were, you know, North Vietnamese Communist Party, but wanted to talk, you know, just to talk. And we went over, there was a minister and a Maoist kid, but it was, a left-wing ex-military and a four-star general with us. And we got there, and all I can remember is the beginning, there had not been any bombing there for half a year. So nobody was expecting. The sound of this siren went off at our second night, second big dinner, you know, welcoming us. And the siren went off, and I'm thinking, oh, they must have these exercises all the time. Then we heard boom, boom in the distance. And, you know, for us, we didn't know what was happening, really. The Vietnamese did, but they were stunned. But they got us down in bomb shelter. And I remember in the bomb shelter, that's where I understood about my own mortality. I mean, I kind of was so frightened. And a lot of times, I'm not frightened. I do this stuff and stay calm, get very calm. But you can't be calm in that. Atheists, agnostics, everybody saying, dear God, please don't let that bomb land on me, you know? Then afterwards, you feel guilty because it fell on somebody else. I mean, it's not a win-win situation. It was pretty terrible. I had a moment when I decided, this pacifist is not going to run to the bomb shelter. And so the next time the siren went off, I was walking very slowly. There was an explosion really, really near. And everybody started running, and I ran so fast. I just lost all my brilliant self-image I had, and I just, blah. I couldn't get there fast enough. I would trample people trying to get to the bomb shelter.
Did you feel that you could comfort people, or did people have to comfort you?
As soon as I was a veteran, which took one night, they had 11 bomb raids in one night, then I'd sang. I'd sing in the shelter.
For the people in the shelter?
Yeah. And it probably calmed me, too, to do that.
A very different venue, indeed.
Yes, it was a different venue, yeah.
You are going to do a song for us. Mm-hmm. And I know you're very concerned about your voice. Mm-hmm. What's happening with your voice?
It's like everybody else who sings. The gravity starts taking over. Pretty soon it will take over everything. But for me, it's mostly started in the throat. It's a muscle in there, and it loses flexibility. And you have to start working with it.
The song you're going to do, it's a song that's very relevant today.
Yeah.
What we've been talking about.
You just kind of drop out of the sky when I was putting this album together. It's called The President Sang Amazing Grace. And it's about the time that Obama sang Amazing Grace after the killings at another school in Charleston. And no other president could have done that. And I hope none of ever tries, because he was this wonderful black man surrounded by, you know, black people in the church. The song says there were no words to say. And apparently there weren't, because he leaned into the microphone and he started singing Amazing Grace. And it was one of the most moving things I'd ever seen. And then this young woman wrote this song about it. So, I sing that for you.
You're going to wear these things.
I'm going to wear these little
on your fingers.
Picks. Well, should I explain it to you?
How does it work?
Okay. Well, this one you stick under your nail, so you can go like that, and you can go like that.
That's amazing.
You can do both ways.
There you go.
Okay. Let me just see how, if we're in tune.
You ready?
Yes, I'm ready.
Joan Baez.
Thank you.
Hope you enjoyed the clip. For more interesting conversations, please hit subscribe.